Haptics is the science of applying tactile sensation and control to interaction with computer applications. Simply put, it's the technology of touch within the context of a virtual world, essentially being able to touch and feel something that technically isn't there. Visual and auditory cues are very easy to replicate in computer-generated models, but tactile cues are a little bit more problematic. It's almost impossible to enable a user to feel something that's happening in the mind of the computer through, well, just regular typical interfaces. Haptics technology allows for real physical feedback. For instance, gamers have been exposed to haptics technology for quite some time. Special keyboards, special game controllers allow for feedback from the game system to the player instead of just experiencing the game through sight and sound. These devices allow the user to feel, let's say, the vibration of an engine or the recoil of a rifle or even the impact of a punch. What started out in the gaming world has expanded into other areas. Haptic technology is being utilized in simulators as an aid to train a variety of professionals from airline pilots to surgeons to astronauts. It's also been incorporated into smartphones, so that when you're tapping and poking, the feedback makes it feel like you're tapping and poking, like you're really doing something. Attempting to be a disciple of Jesus Christ in a world like ours can sometimes leave us wondering if we, in fact, are succeeding at all. Not only that, but how do we interact with the world in such a way that it shows that we are disciples of Christ? In John chapter 13, Jesus provides us with his very own haptic as a way of answering these questions. So grab a virtual pew, hang around for a bit. I'm Preacher Bob. You've just checked into Extreme Church. If you love the Lord God, if you love each other as Christ has loved you, then let us demonstrate that love as we worship together today. Come and tell him through singing. Come and tell him through praise. Come and tell him through the silent prayer of your heart. A great and compassionate God loves us, so let us give him our love in return. Come now and join together in our call to worship. Praise the Lord.
Praise God from the heavens.
Shout God's praise from the mountaintops.
Praise the Lord, sun and moon.
Praise God, you shining stars.
All creation praises its creator.
Kings and rulers of the earth, praise the Lord.
Women and men, young and old, sing praise to God.
Let everything and everyone praise the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come into this sacred space this morning, recognizing that we truly do stand on holy ground. When you're among us, we know that we cannot leave this place unchanged. In this time of worship, move our focus away from ourselves and transfer it onto you.
Make our motives pure, and when they're not, grant us mercy and grace and forgiveness. We set aside our own agendas to listen and to follow where you would lead us. May this hour of worship change us as it makes us more like you, for it is in the powerful name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Going to see a man from Galilee, his face shine brighter than the sun. He make the lame to walk and the blind to see. Just think what he can do with me. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It's a creed I can believe in. Oh, how I yearn to do the better turn. With the help of the sun, I'll get there. In this life or beyond, I'm going to see a man from Galilee. His face shine brighter than make the lame to walk and the blind to see. Just think what he can do with me. Been a rocky uphill climb on a long dusty road. Let the footsteps of the ancient seekers guide you. Beside you and above is the promised tire of love. He has rolled away the heaviest stone that the inner light may shine. I'm going to see a man from Galilee. His face shine brighter than the sun. Make the lame to walk and the blind to see. Think what he can do with me. He make the lame to walk and the blind to see. Just think what he can do with me.
So the mystery has now been revealed for all of you who wondered just exactly what was happening back in those hallowed halls of the annual conference within the bishop's cabinet. Now you know that in all of their wisdom, they have seen fit for me to return here. And quite frankly, I'm pleased that they've chosen to do that. I have enjoyed my time here, continue to enjoy it. I love this church. I love this charge. I love this community. It's probably one of the most fun places I've ever been. But please don't let that get out, because as sure as they're shooting, if I let them know that I really enjoy being here, that I'll be gone so fast it'll make your head swim. So, but it is my honor to have been reappointed to the charge here. The God that is revealed to us in the Scripture is a God that is welcoming. He's one that is inclusive. He's a God that directs us to love one another. So as we, the community of faith, come together, we come to seek in faith removal of all those things that stand as barriers to that love. Brothers and sisters, let us lift our voices to yield up all those things that separate us from God, all those things that separate us from each other, all those things that separate us from our very best, as we join together in our prayer of confession. We admit, Holy God, that we find it hard to hear your promise of new life, even when we are dissatisfied with our lives. It is easier to cling to what we know than to risk the unknown. You challenge us to accept people who are different from us, but we are not eager to associate with them. You command us to love one another. Some people are not lovable. Oh God, melt our defenses so we can accept your love and let it flow through us. Grant us courage to embrace newness. My children, God's love for us is from everlasting to everlasting. So believe this good news and receive it with joy, that in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven. With the confidence of those who have been given grace and forgiveness, let us approach the throne of grace to offer up this morning our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. God of us all, we offer our thanks that you're always with us, even during those times that we fail to acknowledge your presence. We thank you that you are constant in your love that always is enfolding us. And we give thanks to you this morning for that ministry of reconciliation with which you have gifted and graced us. Thus, we know that you hear our prayers as we remember those this morning whose burdens we share. We lift up prayers for Jimmy Lawson, for Christian Willard, Doug Rayner, for Christine Rose. In addition, we pray for those this morning who sit in worship and they feel like they're just kind of sitting on the fringe of life. Let our love be so apparent that we draw in those who sit in pain. Enable them through the grace of your love to move from living on the outskirts to the fullness of life as you intended it. We pray that they might taste the richness which is the kind of life that you offer. We pray today for those who feel like they've lost their way. In those moments of stillness, we pray for these that whom we name in our hearts, that they might somehow be able to find their way back to you. Father, you know that we are very often afraid, and yet even so, you call us to greatness and you call us to life. You call us to rise above the challenge of life and living. You even call us to believe in life after death. You promise to protect us, yet we don't always believe that promise. You show us the way to abundant and fulfilled living, yet very often we still just kind of want to go our own way. But Lord, we know that you keep loving us. Your Spirit is always near, ready to guide us, to fill us with confidence. So comfort our own hurting lives and remind us in new and powerful ways of the meaning and the purpose of eternal life. Calm us down and fill us with reassurance and hope. Steady our nerves and soothe our pain. May we know today and always that promise of life eternal, and may we go forth from here renewed and strengthened and filled with courage. We pray this in the name of our Savior, our friend, and our guide, Jesus Christ, who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
do you want?
Mrs. Edwards, I know I ask you this like every week, but would you like to ride to church with me? Oh, come on, Mrs. Edwards, you like my church. We have some hot music. It may not be what you're bumping at all, but it's hot. We get down. What do you say, Mrs. Edwards?
I suppose.
I've heard it said that 80% of first-time church visitors come because someone personally invited them. All people need to feel loved and wanted, and for some people, it just takes having someone offer to give them a ride to church. We have something great going on at this church. People's lives are being transformed by God's love. Your homework this week is to find at least one person who could use a little more of that love and invite them to come with you next week. Trust me, it's worth the extra effort.
Mrs. Edwards, you want to listen to some music on the way? Go ahead, your choice. Okay, here we are. Hi-ya!
Our first lectionary reading for this morning comes from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 11, verses 1 through 18. The apostles and the believers throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him, and they said, "You went into the house of an uncircumcised man, and you ate with him." And so starting with the beginning, Peter told them the whole story. "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance, I saw a vision. I saw something like a large sheet being let down by its four corners from heaven, and it came down to where I was. And I looked into it, and I saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, reptiles, birds. And then I heard a voice cry out to me and say, 'Get up, Peter, kill and eat.' And I said, Lord, no, nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth. And the voice spoke from heaven a second time, 'Do not call anything impure that God has made clean.' Well, this happened three times, and then it was all pulled up to the heaven again. And right then, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea stopped at the house where I was staying. The Spirit told me to have no hesitation about going with them. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered into the man's house. And he told us how he had seen an angel appear in his house and say, 'Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter, and he will bring you a message through which you and all your household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came down on the mess. It had come on us at the beginning, and then I remembered what the Lord had said. 'John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' So if God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way?" And when they heard this, they had no further objections, and they praised God, saying, "So then, even to Gentiles, God has granted the repentance that leads to life." Our second reading is Revelation 21, verses 1 through 6. "And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven, the first earth, had passed away. There was no longer any sea. And I saw that holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And then I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now with humanity, and he will dwell with them. And they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eye. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for all of those old things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, 'I am making all things new.' And then he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, we live with noise and distraction, clatter and constant commotion. Help us to remove this morning all that so that we can hear only you. The messages we receive from the world lead us down a road of confusion and despair and destruction. We need you to lead us on a path to clarify, to be able to have hope and have life. Help us to clear our minds and open our hearts until the only voice we hear this morning through the Word as it is proclaimed is yours. Amen. The text that will form the focus for our message this morning is the John chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. And when he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. My children, I will only be with you a little longer. You will look for me, and just like I told the Jews, I'm telling you now. Where I'm going, you cannot come. And so I'm giving you a new commandment. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." The Word of God for the people of God. Those of you who are in my generation, even a generation older than myself, literally the generation that came before all the computer keyboards and all that stuff, remember how we all used to learn how to type? Remember that? We learned how to type on those great big old typewriters that weighed about 700 pounds apiece. You know, you took three people to lift them, had those great big old keys, and you almost had to do chin-ups to be able to be strong enough to press those keys down, you know, so they'd make any kind of impression on the paper. Well, that was, you know, and there was a certain satisfaction from that because there was all this tactile environment that was all around using a typewriter. You could feel the keys. You could hear the clack of those keys. There was something very satisfying about that. And for those of us who have had to or managed to make that transition from using those old kinds of typewriters to now using just computer keyboards, well, that move seemed a little strange. It seemed strange because those computer keys don't really give us the kind of satisfying clack nor the same kind of physical sensation that we got from tapping those typewriter keys. Still, even having said that, even on a computer keyboard, there's that slight sound, and you can still, to a degree, feel, you see the keys sort of move under your finger. But now, what about when you go to send a text message on your smartphone? You ever tried to do that? I got great big fingers. I got Mickey Mouse hands. And so it's a real treat when you ought to watch me when I try to send a text message because, you know, it's like trying to type 12 keys at one time. My finger just won't hit just one key. But the trick is, see, it's all just a sheet of glass. There really isn't anything there. See, it's all a virtual world. You're just a sheet of glass, and you're just kind of touching places on that piece of glass. And we don't get any kind of tactile feedback from that at all. So now the designers of mobile phones realize this. And so they want users to have the same kind of sensation when they touch a touchscreen button that they did when they were using the old computer keyboards or even the old kinds of typewriter, to have something happen that gives them a tactile sensation. This is what they call a haptic feedback. So now that if you go to tap a button, the phone will vibrate just a little bit, assuring you that you have, in fact, activated whatever it is that particular key does. That tiny vibration is haptics at work. Without it, you just have to kind of take for granted that whenever you touch the screen in a specific location, that you initiated some kind of action. Now, if you want to investigate this a little bit, if you want to play with it a little bit, you can go into your smartphone settings and you can turn off this haptic feedback. And it's kind of interesting to do that to get a sensation of what it's like to have no feedback whatsoever. Now, I bring up the whole element of haptics because in a very real sense, it deals directly with what we're talking about in the Gospel of John this morning. What we're talking about here in this farewell discourse that Jesus gives to his disciples. This is kind of his last pep talk before they all go rushing out of the locker room, you see, into that Passion Week and literally into the world. The very last thing he tells his disciples, or one of the last things he tells them, he says, you remember, guys, when I told you about that whole love of the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and I love your neighbor as yourself, and those were the two of the greatest commandments, and all the law and the prophets turn on those two? He said, I want you to kind of set that aside because I want to give you a new commandment. Now, these weren't the smartest guys in the world to start with, and so two commandments were kind of hard for them to remember, so Jesus kind of reduces it down into one. He said, this new commandment is that you just love one another. And by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if the love that you by the love that you have for one another. Now, this phrase, everybody will know, suggests that this love for which Jesus is calling us is a kind of haptic feedback, something very substantial that lets not only the recipients of a loving action, but also those who witness that action, know that they are in the presence of someone who is following Jesus Christ. In addition, this love is also to be some kind of a haptic feedback for the disciples themselves after that time when Jesus is no longer physically with them. Previously, when Jesus talked about things like love, he talked about, well, it was kind of like that, the love your neighbor kind of love. And the immediately comes to mind the illustration of the parable of the Good Samaritan. Here, however, Jesus is commanding the disciples not so much loving the neighbor as to love one another. In other words, he's telling them that when they act in loving ways toward each other as members of the same faith community, they are reflecting his love for them. And remember, just earlier that evening, before Jesus launched into this discourse, he put a towel around his waist and he knelt at the feet of the disciples and he washed their feet to very graphically illustrate for them what loving someone really truly means. That they should, in loving each other, also serve each other. And so, in effect, Jesus is kind of creating a group. A group that's later going to be known as the church, whose primary identifying characteristic is that they love each other, even expressing that love in service to one another. Beyond that very simple rubric, love one another, we can be any ethnicity, any gender, any language, any nationality, any age, any political persuasion, and almost any other thing that you want to tack on to label somebody or identify somebody, as long as we love one another. But the disciples' love for one another is essentially, it is an identifying mark. As John explained it elsewhere. 1 John 4:21, those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. Mark chapter 3, Jesus himself says, whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. Love says a lot about a community like the church. It marks those who express that kind of love as a follower of Jesus Christ. And it says that they know God. Love is the mark. Love is the haptic. Okay? But how does that play out with those of us who are disciples of Jesus Christ right now, right here in the 21st century? in the presence of Jesus? Is the presence of Jesus recognizable in the ways that we love one another within the faith community? Well, most of you have been in church for, lo, these many years, and I've been in ministry for more years than I even want to think of, and unfortunately, all of us have got horror stories about church life that illustrate just exactly the opposite. All the way from silly accounts about church members who just absolutely pitch a fit because we have visitors sitting in their pews. One story. Pastor has an aging Sunday school class, has a shrinking membership. He also has a young adult class that is growing in membership. And so he goes to the members of the older class and asks them to please, if they would, to move to a smaller classroom so this other expanding group can have the larger classroom. And they absolutely refuse. You know why? We're not moving. That's our room. We've been in that room for 40 years. You know, sometimes it seems like loving our neighbors a whole lot easier than it is loving that person sitting next to us in the pew. There are also all kinds of stories about newcomers who don't go back to a church because they didn't feel welcome. There are narratives, and I've actually seen this happen, narratives about women's groups who put locks on the kitchen drawers and cabinets so other groups at the church won't use their utensils and stuff and mess things up. I've actually seen that happen. And then there we have all the church fights that go on, all the dominating members, all the toxic members, all those members who just absolutely insist on passing malicious gossip and the branding of some other fellow Christians as not being real Christian because they didn't happen to either think we were the greatest thing since white bread and hip pockets or, you know, saw things a way different than we do. You see, there's no love in any of that, folks. There's no love haptic at work in any of that. Except now that I think about it, there is a haptic at work. It's just not a haptic of love. You ever go to tap your passcode, say, like, into your phone, and you type in the wrong PIN number? You ever do that? And if you've got one of those smartphones that has a haptic feedback, oh, that thing will just vibrate and just do all weird kinds of things. All this jiggling and to let you know that you're wrong, 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 try it again. Sometimes I think it would be great if we had that kind of haptic feedback in the church. You know, that there should be a haptic buzz or a jiggle or a vibration. You know what? In the back of my head, I'm thinking maybe a high voltage electric shock that takes place whenever we in the church get that wrong. Say. And it lets us know that we got it wrong. You look at behavior like that and you go, so this is the Church of Jesus Christ? You got to be kidding me. But all that notwithstanding, all of us have got horror stories. But you know, there is an awful lot of good that the church does. Sometimes we do succeed. Sometimes congregations manage somehow to put up with and work around or calm those members who just absolutely can't stand when things are calm. They got to stir up chaos, things that probably most even businesses wouldn't tolerate. This shows that we've learned something somewhere along the line about loving one another, even loving some of those fellow worshipers of ours who, quite frankly, are just downright hard to love. We have to remember that a lot of children got their first real understanding that they might actually have something productive to offer the world when we praise them for some role that they perhaps played in a church pageant or maybe for a solo that they sang on in a service on Sunday morning. Maybe a teenager heard their very first call to be a disciple of Jesus Christ when they were in a youth group meeting or when they were involved in a trip with a youth leader or at a church camp somewhere. Some agree to participate in mission projects or in some effort for the good of the community because it was some other church member that asked them to be involved in that. And then we have very simple things that most people don't even think about, things like funeral dinners. You know, that says a lot about love to a family. Visits from lay people to shut-ins. emergency but very quiet and private gifts of financial support to members who have very sudden and very urgent financial needs, prayers that we offer on Sunday morning for one another during those times when folks are ill or where they're going through some hard-pressed time in their life. See, all this is and more is what we might call haptic, very certainly Christian love. There are some followers of Jesus that help people by babysitting when the regular babysitter doesn't show up. Now, I got to be honest with you. When people like that, that will babysit for other folks like that, they deserve a special place in heaven. Because I don't know that I'd do that. I didn't really like babysitting my own kids, much less babysitting somebody else's. But they do it out of love that they have for the folks in the community. Or maybe they fill in for a caregiver who just needs a little bit of downtime, you know, to get away from that particular situation. I served in a church one time where we had a church member that was had terminal cancer, and he was taking injections every day, or actually several times a day for pain. And his wife worked, and they were having to spend an awful lot of money to have a nurse come in and actually give those injections. And we had a nurse in the congregation, and she actually trained some of the church members to give those injections so that various times during the day they could go and visit with him and give him his injection, and the wife could still work, and they could more or less have a normal kind of life. See, that's what love does. See, these are the kinds of things that happen when congregations, even small congregations, you don't have to be a mega church to care like that. We really do express our love for one another through the service and the support that we give to each other. Now, notice here that Jesus said this was a new commandment. He did not say, I'm going to make you a new suggestion. He didn't say, what I propose to you is this. He did not say it was an option. This is a commandment. It is non-negotiable. For the community of faith, loving one another is a command. You do not get to haggle. But, you know, he could have just as easily have said that this was a haptic feedback, something that is done in the presence of Christ involving those in discipleship that lets both the one in discipleship and the world know that that person belongs to the community of faith. Now, in practice, of course, while we might be able to serve each other without hesitation, we are not likely to have the same level of fellowship with everybody. Years ago, great Quaker writer by the name of Thomas Kelly. He said, no single person can hold all dedicated souls within his or her compass in steadfast fellowship with equal vividness. Just as an aside, he considered the fellowship to be so important that he capitalized the F. Kelly went on to acknowledge that there are degrees of fellowship among the faithful. Although all might be within the bonds of love, there are some that are nearer to individuals than are others. Some of those who are not so near to us might be near to other folks. However, we all belong to these various groups, and these groups you see in the church overlap. The total effect in a living church, he said, is sufficient intersection of the bonds to form a supporting, carrying network of love for all humanity. Where the fellowship is lacking, the church is lacking, and the kingdom of God is not yet come. For these bonds of divine love and caring are the stuff of the kingdom. Those who are in the fellowship are in the kingdom of God. Now, in all of this, there is, of course, room to talk about how our loving acts toward people outside the church are kind of a haptic to them as well. And note that in what Kelly has had to say here, when he spoke of the fellowship, he spoke of it as a carrying network of love for all of humanity. Ira Gillett was a missionary to East Africa. And on one of the occasions when he came back to the United States in order to give his report of his activities, he related to the mission board a very interesting phenomenon. Repeatedly, he had noticed that groups of Africans would very often walk past one or more government hospitals and walk additional extra miles in order to be able to get medical treatment at the mission compound. And this happened over and over and over. Finally, he asked a particular group why they had walked all that extra distance when they could get exactly the same treatment at a government clinic that was a lot closer. And one man looked at him and said, well, the medicine may be the same, but the hands are different. And see, that is the virtue of love that is incarnate. That kind of love is love that makes a difference. Jesus Christ doesn't have any hands except ours. He has no feet except our feet. Hands were made to do, feet were made to go. We are his ambassadors. We are representing Jesus Christ to the world. So how come we ain't doing no representing? When we love as he loved us, it makes a difference. People notice. Christian love is indispensable. Those of us who have been around for a while realize that there's hardly any activity, any enterprise that is started with such tremendous hopes and expectations and yet which fails so regularly as love. So what is love? I mean, real, lasting love. Love, brothers and sisters, is the attachment that results from deeply appreciating that other person's goodness. Not just being able to see that goodness that exists in someone else, but appreciating that goodness. Appreciating each other's goodness tells those both in the church and outside the church that the love of God is something real. That is not something phony. I mean, anybody can love folks that's just like them. That's no big deal. Jesus commanded us to love one another. So rather than moan about all the times when perhaps we don't love as we should, let's be glad for all the ways that we already do. Happy for the results that come as a response to that love. But let's also be aware of those times when we fail to be as loving to each other as we ought to be and find ways through the Holy Spirit that we can do much, much better. Let us pray. Oh God, we gather in the midst of a broken world and strive to build avenues of love, bridges of love. Open our eyes and sharpen our hearing. Quicken our hearts to respond to the cry of your children. Help us be light in somebody else's dark world. Help us to provide hope for those who are hopeless. Help us to be a friend to someone who's lonely. And above all, help us avoid making excuses. You know, the ones like, well, let someone else do it, or I'm too busy, or I'll do it tomorrow, or what difference does it make anyway? Help us to move away from relying on excuses, but instead do our very best to present ourselves to you as one that is approved by you, a worker who has no need to be ashamed. Instill in us this sense of urgency in our task so that at the end of the day that we can give thanks for the opportunity we've had to serve someone else rather than to ask for forgiveness for failing to follow in the footsteps of the greatest servant this world has ever known, and that is your Son Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.